very certain definitions of. I know, for example, that housing is a highly segmented sector, and you are not talking about PPP, about whole of housing. You are talking about a particular sector within housing. Maybe you are talking about either people-based, in which case you are talking about housing for the poor, or you are talking about affordable housing, which is slightly different. And we need to define what we are going to be talking about to begin with, when you are talking of housing. You are talking of public-private partnership, and the examples I have heard don't really, they are not in consonance with what I understand by public-private partnerships. Making use of technical expertise of the private sector to construct something and to contract out, to me, is not PPP. That's a separate issue. So what exactly in this discourse of yours, ours, we mean by PPP, maybe we should talk about a little bit. Because again, I am very clear in my mind that, and I hope that I become unclear at the end of this discussion, that housing is not a public good at all for me. Housing is a private good. Yes, we might want that everyone should have access to housing, that's a separate issue, but and I would think of different ways in which I would want to deliver it through good governance, which for me is policy framework and capacities and resources. Yes, and then that puts a different slant on what we mean by PPPs, and what the role of public sector and what the role of private sector ought to be when they bring about these things. Is creation of SOEs or SPVs for delivering certain things like water, etc., that we find, is that a PPP variant or is that something else? Is it closer to privatization? Is a question that we need to look at. Finally, as far as PPP is concerned, I think it has been talked about a lot in India, but rarely invited in. We have not been very successful in PPPs in India to the extent that they ought to be. And very technically, there are three basic issues why we are not really getting there as far as I am concerned. One is the ability to tackle the question of arbitration. Second is of renegotiation, which is at the root of all of the so-called corrupt practices that emerge out of PPPs. And the third is the whole risk-sharing debate. And we don't seem to have, especially in the public sector, the capacity to understand and to write contracts that would take care of this. We should have automatic triggers that without discretion, you would know when arbitration is required, when renegotiation is required, and how exactly are we going to value and share risks. And we perhaps need an institution and capacity which specializes in these areas purely technically. But I'm sure that the discussion here is going to be more broad-based, and I look forward to learning from whatever is being said, and I'll come back at the end if there is time, and I'm sure there will be. We go on till what? Up to almost 1 o'clock.
Yes.
So each one of you can just relax and talk for about 15 to 20 minutes. So may I welcome Darshini to make her presentation, please.
Setting some of the agenda for the session. And actually, it's been interesting to listen to the introduction of this workshop. And thanks, Pranjal, for this expanded introduction, which is sort of uncalled for, necessary. I agree with Abhay that when this urban housing subset, conundrum, urban housing is being discussed, and if we look at what it means, and if we look at what the programs have done till now, then there is a confusion in its definition itself. Second thing, that the discussion is on PPP, so obviously the whole idea is the policy context, that we are looking for a right role of the state rather than of the private sector. At least in housing, because it's not exactly what water would mean or what health would mean or education would mean. To some extent, housing is indeed a private good achieved by the household. When we look at the Indian context, I think still 90% of the housing, I mean, whatever government, in the policy context, whatever has been the engagement of the state with the housing, it touches at any point in time not more than about a few percentage, less than 10. This is a small calculation I had done that if basic services for the urban poor, the money that was allocated under it, were to be utilized, and I use the word were because there are lots of bottlenecks involved in the delivery of housing. If it were to be utilized, only 8% of the housing shortage calculated in 2012 would have been achieved. And so there's very little role that the state has played in terms of housing. But this debate of state provider versus enabler has been continuing. I mean, as a student, I was introduced to this as a student of master's student and PhD student, and so you can, since he didn't mention the number of years of my practice, but it also goes beyond 20 years, which is the cutoff mark, as I understand, to sort of tell that you've reached the stage of confusion. So, we've been hearing this for this, and one is not able to make a sense of the debate. So I just, the first thing I want to show is that what is it that we have meant, in spite of less than 10% or so of engagement of the state with the housing. One would still want to see what the state has been doing, what the private sector has been doing. In private, I mean the company, the formal sector. The other is all lumped with the community. I don't know an NGO. I don't think these are the two correct words, but I really have no idea about what it means. PPP is also being talked about in the context of, let's say, neoliberal paradigm being up. But in India, there was no liberalism and there was no state presence to begin with in most of the sectors. And that in health, for example, 85% of the expenditure is out of the pocket expenditure. And in states like Gujarat and Maharashtra, where we come from, there's much, much more presence of private sector. But there's also philanthropic private sector that has been present for the last 100 years. So Gujarat University was set up by philanthropic capitalism. The big hospitals in Mumbai and Ahmedabad have been set up by philanthropic capitalism. So there's a history of that over time. But besides that, we never had European welfare state. And so the question of moving to neoliberalism doesn't exist. So I think when we talk about PPP also, we have to contextualize that India never had a welfare state in spite of pronouncements in the constitution and in the policies. There has been this global debate on enabler versus provider and what it means. It tells us whether these conditions could have been met in India. I also want to show you some evidences coming from India as to what has been the sort of delivery, if it is the public sector, it's the private sector, or what are the outcomes of some of the interventions that have happened in the housing sector. And so I present the final discussion, the last slide. And I don't want you to sort of read through it, but I just started putting all the programs together to see what each one of them is doing. And so for us, housing program has also been community development program. It's been also earlier shelter programs, slum upgrading, in which there have been different roles of different organizations. Initial years, there was this big euphoria about state intervention, and we were in the so-called socialist frame. And so state was stepping in to do all, but the private sector, which is, I would mean, organized formal private sector, was not present. There's community household level efforts, which could be partly informal sector. And informal is also not one sector. It could be households, it could be groups of households, it could be a actor-driven process. So it's a whole complex sort of mechanism through which it happens. So these are all shelter programs where you see largely this was anchored by the government or public agency. And in Indian context, we have plethora of organizations. So it could be local government someplace, slum clearance boards in other place, and so on. And so it could be city level agencies or a state level agency. And when you see their governance and mechanisms are different, their closeness to the community and is different. So it makes a lot of difference when it comes to governance. But as we move on, from 2000 onwards, the first very much philanthropy-oriented private sector in participation in slum redevelopment came through some programs in cities like Ahmedabad, Indore, which was called slum networking program, where the finance, part of the finance was came from the formal private sector, and part of it was contributed, it was a partnership, part of it contributed by the households themselves, and another part coming from the local government. So the PPP was considered only from the financial angle, and provisioning was by the community. They themselves managed to construct, or they oversaw the construction. There could be private contractors, but it was the community who was charged of managing the construction projects, largely infrastructure. And there's water sanitation in the slums. It got sort of discontinued because there are not many private sector philanthropy organizations that came forward to support it. And at that time, India did not have a CSR policy to get directed finance from the private sector into such programs. Then from 2001, largely we see is there's a shift in paradigm to purely constructed housing being delivered. So old programs may have continued in cities. One other deviation that came was in Mumbai in 1995, which was called slum redevelopment scheme, where the first time builders came in to redevelop slum on site, which was also a construction program. In both, as far as largely the land contribution was from the state, that is, it was largely, if it was a municipal land, one could do that, but if it was a private land, there was no answer to it, because you cannot, without negotiations and market price being delivered to the private owners, this would not have been possible. When we start looking at it, there are multiple layers of complexity, especially with regards to land when it comes to any of the housing programs. Given the fact that migration has occurred and people have found their own answer to housing and they've been living on various kinds of lands, there has been policy assisted sort of informality because of the Urban Land Ceiling Act. A lot of lands were encroached upon so that they did not be given away to the revenue department for redistribution. And so a lot of slums in Mumbai and Ahmedabad, at least I'm familiar with the cases, other cities I don't know. There's a large segment of informal housing actually exists on private lands. And these lands now, their status in a limbo. At the moment, some places, some policies are being there to address that. But still, the land belongs to private, there is squatting on it, there are informal financial transactions happening between the occupants and the private landowners through various link of actors that who are there, who are also private developers in the informal domain, and there's not private. And so you see there's a mishmash of actors and agencies from private and public sector engaged. And so when this kind of informality happens, the state is also present as a rent seeker. The lower rungs of the state are present as a rent seeker. And so you have a sort of collusion or cooperation, whichever way one wants to see, of actors coming from private and public sector. In even the development of informal settlements. I'm saying this at a detail because this is what Indian cities are. 50% or more in most cities are still of this kind of development. So if we're needs to resolve this tangle of PPP in the housing sector. You could deal with the new construction, but what about the existing city that you have? And that how are we going to, and it does not, the PPP lens actually doesn't help us to solve. If we go predetermined with a lens and try doing it, we need to reconstruct from and find more practical. And so I agree with him that you get confused and then you say, I'm not coming into it from any kind of ideological angle, but I want to have a practical solution to what exists in our situation. And so SRS probably had a very little coverage because you have this complex land tenure and it doesn't really solve the issue of how do you clear land titles. Interestingly, in a study that we did in Ahmedabad, people felt more safe if they were encroaching on private land than they were encroaching on public land. It does tell a lot about the state and its character in India and the great essence of Indian democracy that we talk about, that if you, and especially more so post-economic reforms, where cities were expected to transform rapidly, and I think this the catchword of transformation still rules the world in urban policy making, and that transformation then comes to evictions immediately because it's very and it's where the issue of squatting on lands in common land, it's when I think the state wanted the lands back for raising finance for various other purposes. And so from city to city we find the lands, public lands, not being given. So the whole important idea of enabling mechanism of providing of housing was based on the notion that the state will provide land. I think because now the PMAY is not working very well, we have gone back to that idea that the state is going to provide the land, but we'll come to that later. And so we move on, but since 2000, there's been much shifting emphasis on construction of housing. From earlier notions of improvement. So that's where it's called housing by the public sector, but it's private sector is engaged in its delivery, in construction, etc. They're not the drivers of the program, but they are engaged in the delivery of housing. But since 2009, it's fully driven by the private sector. And what we find is government acting as a regular and provide regulating housing, giving policy framework, and fiscal subsidy. Recently, about 2-3 months back, there has been a new amendment in the new program which says that government lands will be made available for Prime Minister's Awas Yojana. And there are a plethora of 6 new forms of what they call PPP have been designed. And so you have now 10 options in Prime Minister Sahar's Yojana, with largely housing for the middle class. That's why we are shifting today. Earlier rhetoric, I would say, was also there to involve the households and communities in the programs and their implementation. That's also now shifted. Households have purely become customers of the housing. So in this context, it's now housing being seen as a product, whereas earlier we were seeing housing as a process. And so even if it was private, housing is a private good minus, I would say, about 2 components of it, the land and water sanitation. So structure could be incrementally improved, but land is not available. And is land, and so if you want to talk about PPP in housing, the key question is land, is land a public good? We tried with you, Alsa. I think you might see a smile on your face. We tried with Urban Land Selling Act and it didn't work because it was considered as. But many of the state programs have not worked because deliberately the legislation has been framed weak. even if there is renting, also had his sections 21, 22, 23, etc., which gave an escape route for state not to deliver. So the jury, I mean, the debate still remains in looking at introspection on about that legislation and why it didn't work. And second thing is, as he started with saying that the whole idea of PPP comes because you have governance failures from the state side in delivery. But that's not an economic, purely economic argument. Governance failures need to be fixing up your democracy rather than saying that the laws are not working. So I think that's kind of a mixing up of arguments here. The land today is a big question in most of the cities, probably artificially jacked up prices, and I'll show you some of the data that come from property prices that we have. And anyway, so when we talked about, and I'll just show you some data in shortly about what are the prices of property and affordability that we talk about in Indian city, and where are we going if PPP, in terms of Prime Minister Saras Yojana, is the argument. There have been, this is the UN Habitat, the formulation of what is enabling strategy for housing. Is developing property rights. Now there's a big dispute on property rights, regularized land tenure. There's again a dispute on what do you mean by regularization right. Is the De Soto way of giving land rights, or it is multiple types of tenure, it is de facto tenure, etc. That's still not settled. And then basically move towards privatizing the public housing stock and taxation. Interestingly, in many cities, even if the land titles are not clear, the municipal governments tax, give property tax. And that creates a great, a huge amount of tenure security in many of the informal settlements today in Indian context. For whatever reason, property tax in the informal sector has come through. Largely, I think municipal governments are bankrupt everywhere, and whatever is the revenue source, they're just taxing, and they're giving water sanitation primarily under the local electoral politics. And so why not take charges for that? And people are willing, and they're much more willing to pay the tax because then that gives them a de facto tenure right in the city. The other argument is to give mortgage finance. But to us, in this whole informal sector, what? There is no mortgageable land rights. And so build a financial mechanism as it's being talked about, and that's what over half of the cities are. How is it going to work out? And you know, at the end of the table, we would see that PMAY nearly fits into the kind of framework of enabling housing that's been presented. PMAY for versus Prime Minister Savat Yona, the current fashion flavor of housing policy, we don't know how where it would go. Rationalizing subsidy, transparency in subsidy, and so today you have for the low income households, you have 3% subsidy directed. Now it is going to work in a context and targeting the subsidies. It's working in a context where only 3% or 4% are taxpayers in India, so you don't even have an assessment of income. And how are we going to actually then target subsidies if this was to be a regime that has been developed? Cost recovery, land development, and those who are coming from planning discipline and the way plan works and land use planning works, we know that coordination on land development is very, very difficult because of your whole land titling, lack of clarity on land titling that we have. Anyway, some of the others are minor points. So this is what enabling strategy was, and I think PMA fits into this, the new approach to housing. But it's been framed after the World Cities Report of 2016 claiming very loudly that over the last 20 years, housing has not been central to the national and international development agencies. The housing policies put in place through enabling approach have failed to promote adequate and affordable housing. And this is a global observation on enabling strategy that it's not really worked, and each country, because of the, if we look complexity primarily on the land ownership status, that we are not able to legalize land tenure. And when Rajiv Awas Yojana as a program was floated in India, and it met its infant death within a year of its formulation, because it came from an ideological perspective, and it was fairly well inclusive program, that it got killed in 2 years' time. Incidentally, the government shifted, but I'm not sure whether it would have still continued with the same government. And so largely affordable housing has remained as a rhetoric which is moving, is supporting and helping middle class to achieve ownership housing. I think the faith in public sector has been a bit shaken up on housing front, because some of the public sector that housing that we have seen, and a little bit of evidence is of basic services for the urban poor, for those who, it was also very large public housing program. Lot of it was badly done, large number of it was on periphery, and so today, even though after about 2014-15 the program ended, 25% of the new housing stock constructed is unoccupied, because it's on the periphery and people are just not willing to move into the periphery. Some of the detailed primary service we have done, I'm not presenting, but the conditions of living are abysmal. There have been wrong inclusions and wrong exclusions, as the governance failures when government comes in, rent seeking and others get kicked in, and so people who are not so to be eligible and beneficiary have got in, and those who have not. And so because the government was left hanging, local governments were left hanging with large amount of housing stock, in many cities it had been converted into a resettlement program rather than housing for the poor. So this is mapping I've done for one city, but if you see, they were largely scattered around on the peripheral sites, and I can, in another paper, we'll look at the numbers. In some of it, this is the quality of construction, and that one would find that slum living in many conditions could be better. And this, I just want to point out this lady who is 4 feet 10 inches small, so which is, she's malnourished, poor slum woman. She had to bend to walk through the passageway, because the landing was at 5 feet. Now, if the first thing we are taught in architecture school is that your landing has to be 7 feet or 8 feet for even Indian anthropometrics, but this is not what was done. And this was the site we visited after a year or two of its construction, and it was really very.
That was BSUP.
BSUP Bhopal. It got the best BSUP award from HUDCO. We did a social audit of this team, and we're really shocked to see what it was. The second thing is, in terms of design, the toilet is next to the kitchen, and water has to be filled in from the toilet for cooking purposes. Doesn't suit. The last slide that I want to move on to, the two, three other arguments I have, and I end, is that the water was provided because each water, because there are conflicts on water supply in all BSUP sites, where somebody draws away all the water and then everybody else with left hanging without water. So they said, no, each house will have one water tank. But then they forgot to connect it by the, and so the apathy and the critique of public sector getting into construction and providing housing, this is an evidence of it. It can be done mindlessly and completely, and they forgot to construct the, connect it with a pipeline to get the water at the top, and then they realize there's no pipeline connection, and they give garden hose to connect the connect it at the top. And so women had, then there was no pressure because water was not going up, so women climbed up to fill up the buckets and take it down, and all kinds of, I think Amita, you would have seen all kinds of bizarre functioning in some of these BSUP sites. In one of the case, actually, it was sad because a girl died, fell down and died by filling up water. Or we have in Ahmedabad, you fill up the water from the tank above and take it to the fourth story. It could be either way, one could be working. Anyway, so I don't want to. In some cases, things have been better done. This is not better done, but in Pune, for example, things have been better done because there was an NGO involved in the whole process, and that's how at least it is partly better done. So if this is not, and we move to PMAY kind of a provision, and if the housing is at the market rate, and if even if housing 3% subsidy is given to the EWS, let us look at just the blue color. And what we find in City Arthur, this is Numbio database. It's a very well-known database. And what you see is if we say income to housing affordability ratio in India is 3, so your total value of house is 3 times the annual income, then that is the horizontal line that we see. And you see the blue is for the EWS. It's a smallest housing size, 25-30 square meter. In all cities, it's not affordable. And you could see, except some of the cities, Hyderabad, Guwahati, towards the end, even the smaller cities, the housing prices are so high currently that the private sector smallest house is not affordable. If you look, this is in, I think, in central and central area, and this is on the periphery. And so PMAY in the periphery is also not affordable. In Ahmedabad, peripheral housing is like 40 lakhs, 50 lakhs, that is 4 to 5 million rupees for a household with income of, say, 10,000 rupees a month. It's just absurd, you can't just reach there. And this is very clear, even rental housing is not affordable. And this is for the rental. On the periphery, some places it is affordable. Its percentage of, if we consider 25% or so is the affordability towards the rent, then you see that most of the city central renting is just not possible. Peripheral renting may be possible in half the cities. So this is one problem. You see state failure. You see market not catering. And then you have this reality, informal housing, which is working. And this is a map which is talking about can town planning scheme actually formalize that, and that's also not working currently, because the land belongs to multiple landowners who are farmers, and there are no permissions taken, and then there is an intermediate developer, and then it's sold to a second tier of developer into a society, and there are so many people living very high dense development that it is just not possible. Any kind of planning, this is a map and study, and that when planning came up here, how much of demolitions would have occurred. And this is Bombay Hotel area in Ahmedabad. Amita knows about it because we have presented it many times. And so when planning came to this locality through local planning mechanism, it would have led to about 20% demolitions. And so people protested and the plan got changed. So, right now it's called in limbo. It's stuck because we have no legal tools to unravel the complication of land ownership. So this is the kind of a conundrum that the state leaks, and it's inefficient as we see. Affordable housing is for the middle class, because the poor are not anywhere in the horizon for the new program that has been done. And we have no tools, and we don't want to also develop tools and to create situations where we can negotiate the land issues in the informal sector currently. There is none. No matter whosoever is campaigning the town planning scheme is going to give you an answer, it doesn't give you an answer. There is no currently no tool to do this. In this maze, I find this whole discussion on PPP and its role, etc., to be a bit of a misfit, because I don't know what is private sector, what is public sector, what is the household sector. And within the private sector, there is, as Amita said, there's gradation. People who depend, there's an how much of extent of informality or how much of extent of violation of rules that a private firm sort of carries out. And in that context, because people love on margins. And so in that context, this would, we need to sort of unpack the private sector if you were to see and who are the actors in that context. And so I leave myself, and I have no answer.